Hey everyone, welcome back to the channel. Today we're talking about training volunteers and how to do it. Super important. We don't really do it. We should probably be doing it. How do we do it? Find out next. Before we get started, make sure you smash that subscribe button. It's right here? Nope, it's definitely right here. I don't know. What's in one of these corners? Comment down below. It really helps me with the algorithm. I would love for you guys to comment and let me know, hey, I really like this. Hey, I hated it. Just comment anything. Is there a product that you want me to talk about? Is there a thought process? Tons of those kind of things. I got podcasts as well. It is Creative Arts with Justin Edmonds, and I'm getting ready to go and do another live video at the end of this month with Jonathan Coleman from Cornerstone University. Super excited to talk to him. So that is more of just like a live broadcast of a podcast recording. So make sure you tune in to the channel. It's gonna be on a Monday this month, which we normally do that is on Sundays. But I will get the date and I'll post it in the description here. Make sure you're checking out the website. We've got a blog up there. Most of it's this video content. There's some like expansion on what I'm doing here. So make sure you check that out. It's emtmi.com. If you guys need help with a project or want to buy some product and stuff like that, you can also contact me there. I can help you guys out with that. If you just want some advice, I can also help you with that. It's not just about making money, but it does help support me. So thanks so much. So let's get into this. Boom. How to train volunteers. That is a very broad question. Most of these questions are very broad. And I mean, I think that broad questions are good questions, which is why they're so complicated. All right, let's put it this way. The way that I train people is I'm a big proponent of making sure in the church that people are there because they want to be there, because God is calling them to be there, or something along those lines. Like they want to serve, I guess is the better thing. I want servants' hearts. And that's the biggest concern for me. So with that being said, how do I figure that out? So the church that I was working at, I mention this all the time, our college ministry was probably the biggest influence in my career and just working through what we worked through and figuring out how to make these things all work. So what we did was we made all of our AV people that wanted to volunteer for us, we made them all greet at the door first. So that was like the first step. And the reason why we did that is that was kind of our way of like weeding out people that just wanted to be up there because they thought it was cool or because they just, you know, they wanted to say that they volunteered, but they didn't really care. For the worship team, we made them volunteer with my department. And so we made them do lights and graphics and sound and stuff like that before they could be on stage. And that was the same thing. Like that helped weed out the people that just wanted to be on stage so that they could be like, look at me, I'm on stage. So that's kind of the foundation, simple thing. We never made them do it for super long. It wasn't like, hey, for 6 months, you have to greet at the door. It was like, hey, for the first 3 weeks, we just want you to greet at the door. Now, if they were already someone that was like greeting at the door or doing something along those lines, then that was a lot easier and we didn't make them do that because they were already doing that. We also made all of our volunteers help the worship band. So whether that be take down their instruments, wrap up their cables, whatever that may be, we made them help them specifically do the things that they're responsible for, not things that us AV people were responsible for. We did that specifically because we wanted more community and we wanted, again, a servant's heart because there's nothing worse than having like the worship team think that they're, hey, look at me, I'm the worship team and I'm in charge and I'm cooler than you mentality, or the AV people thinking that like all the worship people are stupid, like because they don't, you know, they think that they're so cool because they're the worship band. So we tried to like humble some people and just make it so like, hey, the worship band, you're gonna help the audio guys, and audio guys, you're gonna help, you know, out the worship band. So it was like, what ended up happening was really kind of cool. We ended up doing a lot of prayers together. We would do meet up and greets all the time. So if the worship band did something, the AV department was there. If the AV department wanted to do something, the worship band was invited. We never did anything by ourselves. And we did that intentionally because we are a team. Just half of our team's on the stage, half our team is behind a sound booth. So that was super, super important. So that's the ground level of our volunteering and how we were training our volunteers. Because those things set the foundation of the attitude and the thought process of going forward. Level number two for the AV team. People want to run sound. It's like, that's like the number one thing that people want to do. The route that I started taking with doing these trainings was for two reasons. Was one for making sure that quality was upheld, and two was because there was people that I wanted to volunteer that were just scared of all of the buttons and, oh my gosh, I can't believe you know how to do all of this. So what I did was I came up with this thought process that made the most sense for me as I was going through and trying to figure out what's the most complicated thing about running a service. The most complicated thing about running a service is not necessarily physically running sound or anything, it's the cues, following along, knowing the flow of service, and knowing how to adapt and adapt quickly. So what I do is, number one thing, when you are officially starting to volunteer for me, you are running graphics. Now, we use ProPresenter, which most of you probably do. This kind of goes along for everything. We put every single thing in ProPresenter. There was not a single moment in service where there wasn't some level of a cue in ProPresenter. Now, that cue could be super simple, where it's just like, there's not anything going on, put the blank background up, because that's what it is. But the entire service flows through ProPresenter. You've got pre-service graphics, you know, all the announcements that are running. That has to be playing along with music that's playing for pre-service. Cool. Well, we do countdown. I'm sure most of you guys do countdowns. So cool. So now you have to trigger the countdown, make sure that the right music's playing, all those kind of things. You know, now we're in worship, graphics, all the lyrics have to be up there. Can you flow and can you work on your toes if the worship leader decides to change the order of the songs or add, you know, a tag or something along those lines because the Spirit's leading them? Can you keep up with all of that? Great, awesome. Now we have maybe some video cues or announcement slides, something along those lines. Pastor goes up, you have the pastor's graphic, you have the pastor's lyrics, the pastor's scriptures, all those kind of things. Then that ends. Maybe that goes back into worship, maybe it doesn't, then you have to cue the ending. All of those things, like there are so many cues that are kind of broken down in there, and you need to be able to follow those cues. And running ProPresenter is easy because it's just kind of clicking, 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 clicking. And once you've done that for a specific amount of time, then you know how the service flows. For the most part, our services will always flow the same within reason. Maybe a change here, maybe a change there, but it's easy for you to know what's going on. If you come from not volunteering in anything that is service flow related to being service flow related, the complications of being able to be running sound and looking down and not paying attention to what's going on, and then like realizing, oh, I just heard, you know, Jim go up and start talking, like, because maybe his mic's unmuted, you know, already. There's just so many things that you need to be able to know. So that's why running graphics is such a big foundational piece for my tech team, is because it gets them, A, if graphics isn't there, someone doesn't come in to run graphics, guess what? If you're running sound, guess what you're doing? You're running graphics. So you need to know how to run that anyways. So now the foundations of service flow are accessible. So now that person gets to graduate to whether, maybe that's running lights, maybe that's running sound. I like to have my guys know everything, because we had so many times where, you know, we're working with volunteers, someone gets sick, someone can't make it, someone forgot they were on the schedule. Now, hey, I can't have you run sound. I need you to run lights. You know, I'm going to run sound or whatever that may be. So now that, you know, I move from graphics to lighting. So because the lighting is the next biggest cue, and being able to finesse that making sure that they're flowing, making sure that they're understanding like the emotion that's going on in service. Like it just helps them wrap their mind around that. And lighting is the next biggest component to be able to do that, because you're really setting the mood during worship with the lighting set. And it's like, if you know they're singing a really nice slow song and your lights are going like this, you know, or you know they're like really bright or something, it can get really weird and not set correctly. So lighting is usually the next step. A lot of that is, again, like I said, just I want them to know how to run it in case someone's not there. Then they get to run sound, and they get behind the console and they're usually pretty excited, but they already know, they feel confident because they know how the service runs. They ran the light board, you know, so like they're starting to get a little bit more of the technical, like it's not just clicking a simple mouse and whatnot and presets for the most part there. It's not as complicated because everything's pre-programmed. I'm not asking them to program lights, I'm just asking them to run the lights. So now that they're running sound, they're a little bit more confident. They don't feel overwhelmed, and they also know how the service flows. So when worship ends, they're not going, "Oh yeah, pastor." You know, like they know worship is ending. I should probably get ready to turn pastor's mic on, or the announcement person's mic on, or whatever that may be. Or there's a video. Like they now know, hey, what to ask the graphics person. Hey, what's going on next? And, you know, those kind of things. They understand the service flow, and I think that's really, really important. If you notice, I haven't mentioned anything about any of the technical training. None of that is important to me. The reason why I say that is, at some point in time, you're gonna get it. I can't teach you how to be creative. I can't teach you how to hear certain frequencies. You're either gonna have that or you're not gonna have that. And if you're running sound and you're trying to get a hang of it and you don't really understand it, you know, I don't now have to go, "Well, you're not good at sound, so I can't have you running sound, so peace, have a good one," and I lose a volunteer. You know, a lot of times what I've found is that people think that they're an audio engineer, and they start going through like the first couple weeks where I'm like explaining how to EQ things and compress things, and they go, "You know, I actually really liked running lights, so if you don't mind, I think it would rather you just have me, you know, scheduled to run lights instead of sound." Cool, awesome. Instead of losing a volunteer at that point, I gained a volunteer for lights. And sometimes those people make it all the way to audio. Sometimes they stay at graphics because they're like, "You know, I should really like graphics," you know? And there's a lot of people that are like that. So I think that's why it's important to do all those things before you get into the nitty gritty technical things. Lighting is super pretty complex when you're doing like the initial programming. And I did all of that. And I set it up for them, so they just got to run it manually for the most part. Here's some basic movements. This is a fast movement. This is a left to right, you know, like those kind of things. So on the lighting side, that's super simplistic of just teaching them what buttons do what and being able to feel it out. Like you being able to feel emotion is pretty good. Most people can feel that, you know. Running sound, you don't have to feel as much emotion in that as you do in lighting. So that's why it's easier, in my opinion, to teach a volunteer to do lights at a pretty good level. And obviously not every one of our volunteers is going to be, you know, able to just go out there and, you know, run a full Trans-Siberian Orchestra style like event. But for our basic services, they'll be good. And the more that they feel comfortable, the more risk they're going to be willing to take. And when you start to take risk, you start to gain skill, and you learn what doesn't work and what does work. And honestly, being in the church world, that's the most forgiving world. So by the time you've been doing it for a year or two, you're going to be pretty solid. So that's how I train people. After that point, once they've been there for a while, you know what they're good at, what they're not good at, and everyone seems to be pretty like set. Now you get to get into the technical things and start teaching them legitimate technical, you know, EQs and compressions, those kind of things. That's how I like to train. So I hope you like it. Let me know what your thoughts are. How do you train your staff, crew, volunteer chunks? I would really love to know, how is your guys' relationship with your worship band? I think that it's really important that you guys focus on that. I think I'm gonna do a video on casting vision for buying equipment. I kind of touched on this a handful of times, but I think that casting vision for buying equipment is a really important thing that I think a lot of us don't know how to do because most of us haven't had to do it. So I'm gonna do that probably maybe next week, not positive, but soon. So, and don't forget to subscribe again. Make sure you smash that like button as well. I'm also on Instagram. You can see these videos on Instagram as well, so you can follow me over there. It's also Justin Edmonds Official. I post, you know, kind of more my like life things, my work things, like kind of everything that's going on. So I'd really appreciate it if you go over there and follow me. I'm almost to 1,000 subscribers. I would love that. Thank you so much for your time. And until next time, I'm Justin. Yeah.